Hi, everyone. My name's Cameron Adamez. I'm giving a talk on, the talk is titled Ethics in Labor and Computing. I'm not really sure that this talk is actually about ethics and labor in computing, but I will try my best to pretend like I stayed on topic while I did my research. A lot of this, and this is a rough draft because we'll see how it goes, and I'm soliciting feedback, so... part of this is actually, these are ideas that I've been mulling over for quite some time, probably since last year, although probably longer than that. I've been a professional developer since college, technically, but I started my actual career here in Portland. I worked for Intel for 7 months, and then I was unemployed for 3 years, and then I'm on year two of my full-time job, so I've kind of been on both sides of this. So I started reading this book, Pedagogy of the Oppressed, which is probably not the first book that you would want to read if you're going to read about labor, but when I started my research, I thought, I'll read this book and maybe I'll have some insight. Well, I did have some insight, by God. my insight was that I'm going to knock this thing over, and that, originally I really wanted to think about, not just, labor from one perspective, but an intersectional idea of what labor is and how racism and sexism and classism, et cetera, affect this. And then I read that book, and then I was like, you know what? I think that computers are actually not part of a process of love, which is kind of it's an interesting conclusion to come to if you're doing this kind of stuff. I think as far as I think I should probably get into what I mean by love, because people don't there's a lot of ideas about what love is. A lot of people just assume love is just romantic, and I would like to actually dispel that a bit. I'm going to read you a little bit of Bell Hooks, who's really awesome, and she wrote a book all about love, and she actually had been trying to understand what is love and what is the heart of, what makes love love. And I'm just going to read this passage, and we'll see how it goes. Imagine how much easier it would be for us to learn how to love if we began with a shared definition. The word love is most often defined as a noun, and yet most astute theorists of love acknowledge that we would all love better if we used it as a verb. I spent years searching for a meaningful definition of the word love, and was deeply relieved when I found one in psychiatrist M. Scott Peck's classic self-help book, The Road Less Traveled, first published in 1978. Echoing the words of Eric Fromm, he defines love as the will to extend oneself for the purposes of nurturing one's own or another's spiritual growth. Explaining further, he continues, love is as love does. Love is an act of will, namely, both an intention and an action. Will also implies choice. We do not have to love, we choose to love. Since the choice must be made to nurture growth, this definition counters the more widely accepted assumption that we love instinctually. So, the reason that I came to this conclusion is because having been unemployed during the start of the recession and seeing a lot of myself and my friends struggle through a lot of this, but also it's hard to escape a lot of those headlines. I was also I did a podcast for about 2 years called Gitmo Nation Roundtable, and I actually did a lot of the tech reporting. Basically, I brought a lot of the tech stories, and a lot of them involved labor. I remember, thinking about Foxconn really was really upsetting in a lot of ways, because it's just, I saw a lot of headlines, and I read a lot of news reports coming out at that time, and I was just disgusted, because how can we live in a society where, I was doing crappy, but I at least had, a roof over my head, and then other people don't even have that, and then other people have to deal with our e-waste. They still burn e-waste in Uganda, and in order to capture stuff to sell, like the gold, because that'll come off of the PCB. But basically, like, there's so many, like, horrible things that keep happening that it's really, it made me really question, like, what is this? What am I doing? Why am I in this industry? Like, this is stupid. And so, and then, you know, then there's the report that came out, and there's been a lot of stuff coming out about Silicon Valley. And I don't think that we necessarily in Portland are dealing with the same level, but Silicon Valley seems to be like ground zero, not just of the tech stuff. I mean, it's been ground zero for a lot of tech stuff for a long time, but I feel like it's also kind of bad, because I'm starting to see this huge divide between the haves and the have-nots. And I feel like a lot of the rich are pretty much going galt. Galt, in this case, is John Galt, one of the protagonists in Atlas Shrugged, who encourages people to go away from more communal behavior and sort of encourage separatism and individualism. And that's Ayn Rand's sort of trustis to how important it is that we all be individual. But once you have a society that relies solely on individuals, you're no longer able to actually have a safety net. And when you lose safety net, if you don't have family or you don't have anything, you're like, there's nothing there to save you. So having that as a keystone is really, it's not good for Silicon Valley. And I feel like that reflects back on the tech culture. And if we can try to mitigate that, I think that'd be good. Here's some stats, because I'm afraid all this touchy-feely stuff may be a bit much. So here's some stats. I took this from the CNN Money report in 2011, although they did some updates in 2013. They found that it was actually hard to get labor statistics from companies themselves, because they actually had to submit FOIA requests to a bunch of companies. Apple was one of them, who was just like, ugh, I'm not doing it. But they got numbers from Intel, and Dell is actually working on trying to show diversity. If you'll notice this chart, white people got a lot of income. 60K is at the top, nothing is at the bottom. White people got a lot, Asian people have some. Once you get into everybody else, African Americans, I'm surprised, are making as much, but that's not really that much. Like 30K, that's like hardly anything nowadays, especially with the cost of living. My brown brethren over here are making like nothing, so I'm not too happy about that. Considering the cost of living increases, which I wish they would put a number in this, I don't know why these charts don't have numbers, but if you look at the average weekly earnings, and pretending that there's numbers here, for some reason CNN was not good about numbers, you can clearly see that people are not, that it's hard to live in Silicon Valley, especially given that, you know, okay, well, if you're one of these white dudes, you're fine, but if you're everybody else, well, better not, like, break a leg, literally. So there's also a video I'd like to play that describes one of the tent cities in San Jose. There's a huge homelessness problem in San Jose, due to the fact that the rent has risen in Silicon Valley, like, oh my god. So,
a year and 4 months ago, I was a working class citizen. I quit my job to go take care of my ex-mother-in-law, who was dying, and because I do in-home care. Went home and took care of her. 5 hours after she passed away, I was asked to leave and don't come back. That was 4 months ago. That's what put me out here.
I've been out in San Jose, a while.
I've been out here since the end of October. Everybody started moving in about the beginning of January. That's when I became tent city out here. I mean, before, and maybe 5 camps on the set. Just that little quad had been alone. That's it. And GD's tent right there. That was it. Now 2013. And it's growing every day.
Most of the people that fail out here in this field now used to stay along the Guadalupe River. It's hard going against cities all over like this. It is. We've done it.
Being out here has humbled so many people in so many different ways. I mean, I grew up upper middle class. My dad's a pastor. I graduated with a 4.0. I mean, what am I doing out here? Sex, drugs, rock and roll. Bad life choices. But then when we get down to it, we ain't got nothing. And we're all each other has up here. It's bad enough we got our society's rejects. And they're already looking down on us. And so that's a lot of pressure as it is. And then being homeless and trying to survive. Not live, but survive. We have the weight of the world on our shoulders. And then what little we do have, they come and take from us during the sweeps. How are you going to rob a homeless person? This is all we have. They don't want us to be here, but yet tell us, where do we go when we have nowhere to go?
Most of the people out here are working with the city and the county to find homes through Housing 1000. I filled out an application last year. They told me it wasn't in the system, so I had to fill out another one.
There's actual families out here. There's kids. I'm 23, she's 20. We're the youngest people in this field. Everybody else is all older.
Oh, you're basically, we're all like a little community out here, like a little family. That we all have our different stories. A lot of us are just trying to make it. We've built up a community, like we were talking before cameras came on, how I've become like the mom of the group, you know? Which happens for some reason everywhere I go.
There's only one shelter here, the Barbados Center, and that's by a lottery. I mean, so it's not good.
Yeah, you go there, you get your number's called,
you need to get in.
Yeah, if your number's called, you're out. If your number isn't called, they'll give you a number to say 12. If your number's called, you can't stay there. If your number isn't called, you get to stay. So there's like, you know, there's like 20 beds, but like about 55 people in line. And everybody gets a number, and everybody gets a fair chance, but only 20 beds, you know?
I mean, I can't talk for other people, but I'm clear here that I have a shelter. I mean, and the city's spending a lot of money sending like cops, paperwork, like the state now with the Fish and Game Warden, but nobody's offering, you know, where do we go now? I mean, nobody's been out here from City Hall to say, hey, you know, we know you guys are homeless, and we, you know, but we got this in place. Nobody's said anything like that.
I don't know, they're supposed to come at 7 a.m. I mean, I guess that really was supposed to be nice. I'm trying to get everybody housing and shelters and everything like that, but that was when the EAC people went to there and have a real name. To try to help with all that. And then, but I've heard cops come through, like mess up homeless people.
I'm taking my tent, my bedding, all my shoes, because they ain't getting my shoes this time.
We're supposed to be out here for 72 hours, and we don't even have a clue as to where to go. We don't want to go somewhere else and have them
arrest us,
you know? So we don't know. They told us to come here.
That's the whole thing, you know? Like, you guys come out here, the news comes out here, our outreach centers come out here, but nobody from City Hall has come out here to say, you know, we do understand that this situation is thick like this.
We're just trying to live our lives just like everybody else. And they're taking what little we do have and throwing it away. And then fining us, and then imprisoning us. It's very unfair.
There's no violence here, everybody's just, you know, down and out and just trying to get back on their feet, that's all.
Society has pretty much washed their hands of us. And for myself, I just, I've been lucky. I got a call today, you know, that housing went down there. And so my issue was my dog, you know. She's all I have left as far as family. And why should I have to, you know, have her taken from me too? So something I was out of control, that was out of my control.
We're just, we come into some unfortunate situations to where we ended up here, you know, couldn't afford rent. You know, I lost my place, second Julian, in July. You know, I've been homeless since August 1st. You know, I've been out here. And it's hard, you know, it's like the economy, trying to find a job. I mean, you know, I got my buddy college educated. He can't even get a job at McDonald's or Target. You know, they're like, well, no, you know, not right now. It's like, it's crazy.
This is just not a tent. This is my home. The best I can do for today. Where are you supposed to go when you don't have nothing and nowhere to go?
day. Every day. And, you know, I mean, they have to brush your teeth in the bathroom or at work and wash them. I mean, come on. But they do it because they don't want to be here. We don't want to be here. We really don't. But, I mean, you know.
Yeah, but with your family member out here, would you still feel the same? You don't know it.
Unfortunately, names were not included, but that's okay. And I'm sure that a lot of their stories seem familiar to you. At the same time, so to segue very abruptly, last year I went to the Open Hardware Summit, and the keynote speaker was Chris Anderson. And Chris Anderson used to be the editor-in-chief of Wired Magazine, and now he started a thing, DIY Drones. And I listened to his talk, and his talk was mostly about business, because one of the things in open hardware, I'm sort of in the open hardware community, one of the challenges is actually how do we make it a viable business? How do we make sure, you know, basically that our needs are met, you know, that we're able to both, you know, pay for the cost of hardware, which, you know, there is a cost, and how to actually, you know, make a living doing this. So I'm going to play a clip that kind of bothered me, because I was like, I was listening to talk, and I was like, oh, this is okay, this is okay. And then he said some stuff that really made me go, what did you just say? I can't believe those words came out of your mouth. So,
So everyone asks, how do you incentivize people to participate? And well, this is kind of where we've come down. And we have a big dev team, you know, I guess more than 100 active developers. And, you know, on strict code and many more on other bits. And what we do is we sort of, we have this hierarchy of reward. And what we've come up with is we're just kind of, we're just rolling out the ability to do this. But when people submit some code and it's accepted, they get a t-shirt. And not a big deal, but it's people enjoy the recognition. After they have a number of commits and they get a sustained contribution award, they get a coffee mug and a hardware discount. Again, these are sort of trivial things, but they're meaningful. And the hardware discount actually can add up to some money. If they accept the role as a project leader, which is a big responsibility, then they become a core dev team member and they get free hardware. If they become a team leader of one of the, what turns out to be a core product that ends up shipping, we're now going to start these annual dev meetings. We just did our first one at the SparkFun competition earlier this year, and we'll pay their way to the dev meeting. And then finally, and this is a little novel, we're just now sort of playing it out, if they led a successful project to completion that becomes a core product, we've structured our company so we can give them equity, we can give them stock grant, in the company. It's a little unorthodox. I think it was only been done, I'm not actually sure whether it's, I think it's been done by one other company in the past. But we think this is, you know, who knows whether it's worth anything in the end. But we think that this is the kind of thing that sort of feels right to us. These people contributed so much to what we are and what we become as a company. We want to incentivize them, but simply paying them cash doesn't move the needle. They all have day jobs. You know, by day they work for IBM or Apple or Google. By night they work for us for free, and so we can't write them a check big enough to change their life. And furthermore, if we did write them a check, we'd have to raise the price of the product, which again defeats the original purpose of democratizing the innovation. So we think that the equity is an interesting way to go. Now, obviously, there's some tax issues, especially outside of the United States, and so you have to work with your lawyers about, you know, how do you give someone an equity grant and how do they pay taxes on it and all that kind of stuff. But I think this is an idea worth exploring.
So if for some reason what made me upset about this you didn't quite catch, I'm going to try to make it as clear as possible. So he's one assuming that everyone who contributes to open source has day jobs, which may or may not be true. That day job may not be what you think it is. It may not be I working at IBM. That day job may be I work at Potbelly Sandwiches, and this is my first commit to open source. Just so you know, when I worked at Potbelly Sandwich, my wage was $8 an hour, which was more than I was making in Texas. I worked in Washington, D.C., but I would say $8 an hour is not that much, especially when you are also going to school.
Does being a student count as having a day job?
That is a lot of work. I wouldn't put it in the same category as a day job, but it is a considerable amount of time, especially if you value your time. The other thing that I found egregious was that not valuing... I feel like when you're asking somebody to commit to your open source project and you're making money off of that, most of us would say, that's exploitation. Yeah. And, you know, I think it's hard for us to really come to those kind of conclusions because, you know, I'm not going to say all of us, but many of us in open source, whether it be hardware or software, we really feel like, you know, what we're doing is for a common good. But, you know, a common good of this guy? Like, or a common good of, like, all of us? Because, you know, I'm really hoping that, you know, stuff like, you know, Rails Girls and all kinds of, like, all these coding initiatives will bring people, like, you know, like, how do you know that there's people in that tent city that wouldn't, like, if you taught them to program, wouldn't be like, oh my god, this is so fantastic, I want to do this for a living. Like, you know, like, you don't know until you're actually, like, I think because a lot of people are not introduced to code, so you need to introduce as many people to code as possible and see, what, you know, if they like it or find something that they, just introducing people, casting a wide net. But he wants to give people like that, or like all of us, a t-shirt if we make a first commit. Like, are you serious? Just keep the t-shirt, because the cost of actually printing the t-shirt and having, like, making them, it outweighs the real value of this. And I kind of did this on purpose, the two videos together, because in Freire's work, part of being able to align yourself with the people, with sort of people in other, you know, bad situations, I don't think that we should play sort of oppression of Olympics. Obviously, there are people that are in worse situations than you are, but we all have, like, the same, but a lot of us have faced, like, similar struggles, you know, not necessarily to the same extremes, but if we don't, so there's this idea that if you identify with Mr. Anderson over here, that you are not, that it's kind of either, it's either or, it's not both. You can't really, it's not good to identify with this guy, because in Freire's terms, there is the oppressor and then there's the oppressed. Mr. Anderson clearly belongs to the oppressor category, because he is really excited about getting as much labor as possible out of you and expending very little capital, or really even kind of considering, you know, you until you've, you know, until you've actually taken over the project. Then, well, you know, equity, that's got to be something. So when we allow ourselves to identify with people like Anderson, we slowly become sub-oppressors. That is, we've adopted a lot of their mannerisms and their attitude, and it makes it harder for us to be sympathetic towards other people. Whereas if we try to identify ourselves with the oppressed, if we look at ourselves, you know, if we try to put ourselves in their shoes, or to be friends, or to create solidarity, which is really the goal, solidarity with the oppressed, we see, you know, the bad things that are here, and we try to work out of any of our sort of oppressor ideas, I think that we can actually create some kind of, like, loving stuff. But people, so here's I've kind of given a breakdown. I think I got this out of order, but that's okay. Here's kind of a quote that really sums it up, and actually, this quote really echoed at me when I was working, which is, the earth, property, production, the creation of people themselves, time, everything is reduced to the status of objects at their disposal. This quote somehow rung true with me when I was staring at the whiteboard with my manager, and we were talking about, you know, how are we going to do this new feature, and I realized, you know, object-oriented programming, you can't reduce everything to objects. Like, there's a reason there's, like, different paradigms. because it's kind of, it comes out of our mentality. If we're only thinking about this, then of course everything looks like an OOP problem, and we're going to treat everything like that, when in reality, things are very complicated. We can try to sort of abstract out these ideas as much as possible, but to correctly model relationships or to correctly model anything that's sort of in real life, we should not not only think of things in object-oriented parlance. So I think it's worth looking at how like a computer, sort of the life cycle of the computer. And I kind of start at the top. As many of us in this room, I'm going to bluntly assume that we're sort of in the software or firmware side. Some of us are on the hardware side. But, you know, the software side depends on the hardware side. The hardware side depends on people who are doing components and fabrication. I mean, I really depend on, I can't think of the names, Vishke and Panasonic and all of those people to actually have components that I need. But it doesn't quite stop there. I think that was a naive thought. So I realized, you know what, well, the software depends on the hardware, which depends on components and the fabrication of these components. But all of these things rely on like building support, like janitors. We all depend on the service industry in one way or another, like who doesn't go to a coffee shop, you know, who of other people don't go places. And, you know, even if, like, in Foxconn, you know, they've got people who, I assume, they have cafeterias, and they're, I don't know, but I'm assuming that they have cafeterias, and there's, who's going to feed the people that work there? So, but then at the bottom of all this is agriculture, because we all eat food. it's kind of a crazy thing, but if we don't sort of see ourselves, so there's the concept in biology of like a food web. We are kind of in like a labor web. You know, we really depend on the labor of other people in order to have our job. Whether that's right or wrong is not a discussion that I want to have, because there's I definitely don't think that we should have such hierarchical things. But even if we don't exist in a hierarchy, we still are interdependent, especially as things get complicated. Like, creating things is more complicated than we obviously still depend on other people, regardless of the structure. But knowing that, understanding like sort of that we all depend on each other, and that we're all sort of part of this, we're all little creatures on this little spinny rock, and that we all have sort of similar struggles, that allows us to align ourselves with other people. And I wish I could remember where this report came, but basically, a common thread in a lot of Foxconn workers was that they moved to Shenzhen because they didn't want to be a farmer anymore. They wanted to get away from that. They wanted to actually like better themselves, because you know farmers don't really make a lot, and historically, farmers have been excluded from a lot of labor movements, with the exception of Cesar Chavez's labor movement and that kind of stuff. But basically, they all want better lives for themselves. And I can kind of relate to that myself, because I didn't just like, I wasn't born in Portland. I moved here because I didn't think I had an opportunity to have a good job in my hometown, because my hometown has a lower education level and there's not a lot of jobs other than like Dr. McDonald's in one-stop shop. And I just, I couldn't do it. I couldn't. I got accepted to Lowe's on the floor, making $8 an hour, and I couldn't accept the job. So I moved here. But I understand that sentiment that, you know, you want to do better. And, you know, and it's sad that at Foxconn a lot of these people are being taken advantage of. But I think also, like, I can't, like, you know, I'm never going to be completely like them. And so I need to understand that I also sort of, like, I'm still, like, in this hierarchical structure. Like, I live in the United States. I have many things that are made from Chinese labor. You know, I work at an insurance company. My starting salary was $72,000. I am clearly middle class now. I'm actually doing pretty well, but to know that means that I'm also part of a class that has some influence. I try to keep that in mind in a lot of the decisions I make and what I do with myself. So that's, you know, that's kind of a hard one. And I think recognizing that in ourselves, knowing like both what puts us in both categories, and thinking of like the oppressor as being like, you know, something that we should transform. I think that's good. We should transform ourselves into being just kind of together-ish people. So I feel like I've gotten a little bit wonky, but I think also I don't really want to. I think it's important to not dismiss the work of people in the past who've started labor movements. For example, you know, I think I wouldn't say it's common knowledge, but I think it's pretty well known. A lot of people, like in the video gaming industry, still work like 60 hours a week, and there's a lot of us that have, maybe not now, but in the past, have pulled stupid hours at work, stupid long hours. We need to remember that the 40-hour work week is not—it's not new, but it's not old. It was actually the object of a strike in 1817 in Britain. That was the 8-hour day movement. And that was actually really crucial because child labor was still in effect. But also, like, and in the United States, that was sort of introduced in 1964 in Chicago as part of a broader labor movement. And so, you know, recognizing that people in labor movements have made great strides, we shouldn't sort of reject this. You know, because, oh, I'm a libertarian, I believe everybody in free market, blah, 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 free market's going to correct everything. That's not really true. It's really people saying, hey, screw you, I'm worth something. I have value in that I'm a human being, and, like, don't step on me. Bah! We have to, like, fight for these things. We can't just go, oh, no, I hope somebody comes and rescues us. And I think we also have to be careful too, not to adopt this in some kind of tech narrative, but to actually like use this as a foundation to create to create struggle and to recognize struggle. And so, but we also need to create dialogue with other people. The only way we're going to actually like be able to understand and to cooperate with people is that we create dialogue. We do it by the Mr. Ferry, in his book, says that we cannot be fruitful without hope. We cannot exist without love, humility, and faith, which forms mutual trust. Cannot exist without critical thinking, characterized by reality as a process instead of a static chronology. That means that we are more flexible. I like to think of things in the positive, so we should encourage hope, create a safe area to enable trust, encourage critical thinking, and to be flexible and to learn from our mistakes. To learn from history, but also you should read some history books and talk to people you don't know for poop's sake. Gosh dang it! Like, I can't believe people just totally forget this part. Like, you know, you can't just have, like, you know, chances are if you actually talk to other people that are not in the industry, they probably have some good insights about our industry, even if they don't necessarily know all the particulars. There are people who have lots and lots of historical things. So very quickly, I had some thoughts that, here are some rhetorical questions for you. How can we increase solidarity with overseas workers? And is bringing manufacturing jobs to the U.S. helpful to fight oppression? Considering time restraints, I'm not going to ask you, but just think about these. Like, take a picture if you need to. But just think about them, because I've been thinking about them. Also, I've been wanting to explore these topics in this talk that I didn't get to. Basically, visa programs, immigration, things, how to do outreach to minorities, and in the inherent classism that is in the tech community, which really drives me nuts. How to hire people with a criminal background, because you know some things are not terrible offenses, and we need to like recognize that people with criminal backgrounds are sometimes trying to start over. Like that shouldn't be their penance to bear for the rest of their lives. Also, systems theory, just because we're all together. So if you have any questions or feedback about this talk, because it is a rough draft, feel free to email me. My soycamo is my Twitter handle. My email address is cameron@soycal.org. I'd like to thank all of you for actually attending this, and for some reason, like, I don't know, something, you all are great. And I'd also like to thank Donald Davis for helping me prepare this talk. Oh, dang. Okay. So anybody thoughts, critiques? Did I mess something up? Did I miss something? Anybody? Bueller?
Let's be brief. Oh, I actually love the presentation.
Oh, wow. Holy crap. Thank you.
Yes. Especially since, you know, the intersection between, the intersections that were talked about in the presentation are pretty interesting, particularly coming from, you know, as we're looking, as a student, and I know I'm not paid. So, my curiosity here is whether or not there really are incentives for, you know, to do the things, whether the incentives are strong enough for people to do the things that they like to do, but at the same time, you know, it's not like they're sacrificing one thing or the other.
Mm-hmm.
It's kind of like, I don't know exactly how to phrase it, but that's somewhat how I kind of got how the question was formulated, I guess.
I see. I'm not really sure how to respond to that. But that is something to think about, and I guess just for the recording, that he wanted to know like what the intersection is of what we want to do, and you know whether we have time, and if that's sustainable. I guess as far as labor is concerned, Jim.
There are guys who are in business who answer that question, who make an effort to say what is the smallest incentive that actually serves as an incentive. There are studies that show that if you incentivize too small an incentive, people take offense. And I was actually at a university where that happened.
Mm-hmm.
It was remarkable. So there are people who address that question.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know.
Okay.
They come up with good answers or not.
Thanks. Reid?
To channel an earlier topic, you are channeling imposter syndrome quite a lot. You can have a lot more self-confidence.
I'm working on that one.
Right.
I've been paying for that one for 3 years for therapy, but I'm...
I have the question you're wondering that right now.
There's a lot.
But I think, so before you guys get into a big thing, I also want to point out that in my culture, I was raised Mexican, it's not polite to brag.
Yeah.
I try not to brag as much as possible.
She really did put a lot out there and say, this isn't really well put together yet, and this isn't, you know.
Oh, yes, I'm trying to cop to my... Yeah. Well, I'm trying to, I guess, cop to the fact that I worked on this presentation, but I was hoping to be slightly more historical, and so I'm not meeting my own personal thing, but I also want to make sure that this talk goes well, because I'd like to give it at the Open Hardware Summit. Because for obvious reasons. I know, I'm really excited about that. I know, and if I'm lucky, maybe I'll even get a t-shirt and a mug.
Or any other incentive.
Exactly, I might get incentives. Tim? Oh, hi, Tim.
Oh, hey. do you think that in the future, programming will move to being more of a trade and less of a prestige sort of profession? And do you think that will no longer increase the innovation in programmers?
You know, so in some ways, I hope so. What I do like about the tech community is that there's this sense of there's a sense of accomplishment and pride that I hope that actually kind of stays as it becomes more of a trade, because it's not necessarily that. I guess the reason I cite Don in this talk is because he says that it's not. Like, all problems can be solved. Some are harder than others, obviously, but all problems can be solved. It's actually, like, what experience do you bring to the table in your everyday life? What do you bring to the table as a lived person? And what can you do to contribute to a project, sort of your own perspective, which is important, and on also understanding the client needs, which I think there's a lot of, like, soft skills that still need to be developed. But I really hope that we actually go more towards unionization to make sure that, you know, people are well represented, to make sure that jobs get distributed around, not just in like the, like, oh, I know these people kind of group, but to be able to give people a chance and you know, like have, but also like, you know, physical community space is really important for that kind of stuff too. So I hope that addresses your question. Chloe first?
Oh,
we're out of time?
Yeah.
Dang! Oops. Okay.
Are you planning on doing any actual follow-up with the kind of rhetorical, like, how do we connect with the
Yes, because I keep thinking about this stuff.
Okay, so are you going to be, like, tweeting?
If you have any thoughts, email me. I will be thinking these things. I may or may not tweet them. I might even start a blog again. So,
okay.
Thanks.